Well, good evening, everyone, and thanks for coming. I'm sure you'd rather be at the board or having dinner or something, but thanks for showing up to hear me. I really appreciate it, and it's an honor to be asked to speak. And I did bring a few things with me. For those of you who stick it out to the end, there's a good pen and some literature about my firm and a speech that I gave 4 or 5 years ago about building a great investment operation that I think might be of some interest to some of you. By way of background, I really got Burgundy going 20 years ago. One of the things that George's very nice comments didn't pick up is that I had the enormous good fortune along the way doing the things that you mentioned, to be heavily influenced by a couple of people who enormously had a bearing on the way I think about investment. And the first one of those was in the mid-70s. I met Buffett. I mean, it was a complete movement, and people didn't know who he was. I didn't know who he was. But he wrote me a letter in regards to some work that I'd been doing as an analyst on the newspaper business, which was something he was really interested in applying. From the Washington Post at the time. So it was a complete fluke, but it caused me to sort of study this guy very carefully. And then later on, in Gardner Watson, I worked very closely with George Gardner, who was the founder of the firm, and I think is one of the greatest investment people, one of the greatest businessmen Canada's ever had. And one of the things we did when we were there was we hired Prem Watson. I mean, that was one of the things. He was working away at Confederation Life, which subsequently went bankrupt, and I always kid him that I rescued him from an insulting story. But, so, you know, it's so important in life, I think, who you initially get involved with. And there's a real, you know, sort of lesson there, I think, about when you're starting out, like a lot of you people probably are, when you think about the caliber of the people you're joining, because it can have an enormous impact later in life. And certainly, George Gardner certainly did for me. Now, one of the things that today I want to talk about, sort of background. So you've heard a bit of background about me. Really, Burgundy got going 20 years ago. We're in our 20th year anniversary this year, actually. We started with very little money. I think the good reputation that I at the time was in my early or mid-40s. I'd been around long enough, I had somewhat of a reputation, but we really started with very, very little. And I got the firm going and had built it up to close to $10 billion at this time. And I want to talk to you today about a few things. One is the difference and the really important sort of construct to have of being an owner versus being a lender. I think it's a very important point in the world that we live in. I want to talk to you a little bit about what we look for in investments, but I want to emphasize to you too that there's no playbook, right? There's no magic sauce, there's no formula, and I don't think there's any shortcuts, actually, to being a good investor. I want to talk some tonight, too, about an aspect of investing that I haven't seen anybody here speaking much about, which is the sort of human weakness side of investment. Because I think what really gives rise to opportunities are often human weaknesses, human over-emotion. And I want to talk a little bit about that, how to overcome those human weaknesses, which I think are really what stand in the way of a lot of good investing. And if there's time, towards the end, I want to talk to you about a couple of aspects of businesses that I think are so important. One is the whole sort of concept of barriers to entry and what it really means. And secondly, the overarching importance of management in companies. Now, I'm sure that these are familiar statistics to you, but if they're not, and you don't remember anything else I told you tonight, I hope you'll commit these few things to memory. That over the last 90 years, stocks, large stocks, really define, I think, as the pretty much the S&P 500, Standard & Poor's 500 in the United States. Through all those 90 years, Second World War, some smaller wars, Great Depression, etc., counting in dividends and capital gains have compounded at 9.9%. It's a very key figure. Smaller stocks, have done even better, and you can see that they've done about 12% a year, while government bonds have done 5%, and inflation over that time averaged 3%. This is through a lot of good times and bad. And putting it on a graph makes it even more dramatic. You started out with a dollar, it was 1.6, and you put it all in small cap stocks in the United States, you'd have 9,546, and if you just had ordinary stocks, you'd have $2,000, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very dramatic, and really shows the power of compound interest over time. It's a very, very, it's the most important sort of concept, I think, in investing. Now, at Burgundy, we have some fairly simple ideas, actually. And one is that the overarching thing that we think about are absolute investment returns. And in the kind of institutional world that exists out there, a lot of people are really more interested in how they did relative to everybody else. We're not. We're interested in making money and doing it with a little risk. Our focus is on the quality and the valuation of individual companies. We think that it's sheer folly to be trying to think about what the market as a whole is going to do. But we know that thorough research and having a contrarian approach to things can lead to great opportunity in individual companies. And that's really where we spend our time. We concentrate on the best opportunities. We don't over-diversify. We think that most people in life own way too many stocks and they don't actually know that much about them. We try to know a lot about a few things. I think the fourth point is one of the most important, which is it's so important to act opportunistically and not to follow the crowd. This is a big, big talk, and it's really easy to say that. But the real test is what you're doing at certain moments in time. What were you doing in April of 2009 when the stock market hit a bottom? What were you doing? Well, I'll tell you what most people are doing, they're selling stocks. And the public has been selling stocks almost all the time since then and buying bonds, which is sort of a perverse thing to be doing, in my view, when interest rates are so low and stocks are so attractive. So, it's easy to say, stand apart from the crowd, but it's a very, very hard thing to do. It's very important, too, to remember the concept of margin of safety. We don't buy things unless we feel that we can buy them for significantly less than their intrinsic value. One of the really key things is, of course, the caliber of the research that you do. And we are very rigorous about the work we do. We have a large team of investment analysts, very highly educated, capable people. We meet with companies all over the world. Last year, we met with over 500 of them in their offices. About 200 of those were in Europe. It's a really important thing to do these things in a lot of detail. We think that scuttlebutt is a very important idea, and we're always trying to glean out expert information from competitors, customers, suppliers, etc. But you need context. You need context. We at Burgundy have a large private client business with some of the most influential business people in the country. And sometimes they can really be helpful to understand businesses. And of course, being disciplined and paying attention to multiples and the price that you pay for things is such an important point. Really, when you are buying shares, I don't need to tell all of you that what you're really doing is buying a piece of a business. And yet in the world that we live in, I think that not so many people think about shares as pieces of businesses. They're rather thinking of them as, you know, little as though they were elements in the periodic table or something, and you're reading, you know, reading the stock tables and watching Bloomberg. But how many people are really thinking about the business that lies behind the stocks? And really, that is the very key to it. So I think to be a good investor, it's extremely important to understand the business and take the time to know that. So you know, all of you who are taking degrees in business, I mean, this is a very important point, I think. You can't be good as an investor unless you understand companies, in my view. One of the central characters of companies is the idea of, you know, that in the capitalist world, what's the problem with a great idea in the world we live in? What is it about capitalism that makes it? Exactly. So this is the big problem. I mean, the good thing about capitalism is you have progress and people are getting better ideas and improving things. But the problem from an investment point of view is you don't actually want competition. It's far better not to have too much competition. So we spend a lot of time thinking about barriers to entry. Now, what are some of the most obvious barriers to entry that you would think of? Anybody got an example? Yes?
Fixed asset investment. So if you look at Intel, for example, they have spent hundreds of millions of dollars.
Yeah, it is a barrier to entry, but there are people who always could come along with more money. I mean, who would have thought that BlackBerry could have been usurped the way that it has been? Do you think that, I'm going to talk later on in my talk about Walmart. Do you think Walmart's got competitive advantage?
To a certain degree.
Right. To a certain degree, but isn't it perfect, is it? Target and Costco are significant threats. Yes.
You want licenses by the government?
Yeah.
So
I think that's a really good one. I like those ones a lot. And so in this country, this has actually been a really important thing. Investing, hasn't it? Because some of the great businesses in this country have been things like PCE, not so great maybe, but at one time was a great company. Rogers has been a great sort of success for many, many years. Broadcasting was one of the great businesses of all time. So government licenses are a great thing. What about Canadian banks? Didn't they have barriers to entry? Do you think in our lifetime anybody is going to start a bank in Canada? Yes?
There's certain regulations that limit certain companies from entering certain industries.
Right. So I think banking would be an example of that. I don't think that, you know, it would be, I mean, the American banks aren't going to be allowed to take over Canadian banks, which is not. So it's very, very difficult to start a company. Then there are other people who have natural barriers to entry. What would an example of that be? Yes?
Utilities,
yeah. What's the problem there with those kind of barriers to entry?
With the amount of fixing investment required to react.
That's one. What's another one? Why is it the utilities aren't more profitable than they are? Because the government has figured out that they're monopolies and regulates them. So that's sort of not such good. What's another natural monopoly that is, or natural oligopoly that isn't regulated? They're around, you can see them around.
Cell phone's
another kind of thing that which I would call the network effect. You know, if you build a network, it's very hard to compete against Perlick. different kind of barrier to entry because they've got a great brand name. Do you think anybody's going to start up against Coke? I mean, it's very, very hard to imagine. I think those are great barrier to entry companies. Companies with, Tom Russo was up here and talked to, I know, and he really has long believed that, and I think it's been true, that companies with great brand names, very hard to compete with them, take a lot of money and time to build the reputation that Coke has, or Kraft has, or Procter & Gamble has. But there's some other kinds. What I was thinking of was quarries, right? Quarries. Can you think about delivering stone and the economics of transportation? I mean, it's very, very hard. Also, the government doesn't want to grant you quarry licenses. Last week in Mexico City, I saw a company that I thought had a great natural barrier to entry. It's called Cementos Moctezuma. And it's one of the three big cement companies in Mexico. It's right there in Mexico City. They've got a state-of-the-art plant. And their biggest competitor, Cemex, is in bad financial condition. And the stock's reasonably priced and got a big dividend. I mean, those are things that we look for, are companies with barriers to entry. Because companies with great businesses tend to get the economic profit competed away from them over time. It's just the way things work. Now, one of the things that's so important is really the independence of the search. So we think at Burgundy that it's really important to do our own work, to have our own people trained in our own way. We do not find it terribly useful to look at the research of other people. For one, it's distributed to everybody. And secondly, the quality of it is generally not good. And thirdly, many of the people who do that research are actually in other businesses for which they're doing the research. And if you want to get some insights about that, you've probably all heard about this guy who quit Goldman Sachs yesterday and wrote a big letter to the New York Times. But it just illustrates some of the inherent conflicts of interest that exist within major investment dealers. So from the very early days of Burgundy, I've tried to build a very strong capability in doing our own research and training our own people and our own methods. One of the other central ideas that we have is the idea that business opportunities, investment opportunities, exist all around the world, and that if you look for things more widely, you're going to have much more success than if you look at them rather narrowly. It's always amazing to me how so many Canadian investment firms primarily focus on Canada. Canada is a very small place in the scheme of things. I think it's 3.5% or something of the world's capital markets. It's very, very small. I can tell you that if you go to Sweden and you talk to investment people in Sweden, they are not focused that much on Sweden. I mean, most of the money is elsewhere. And yet, in Canada, it's very common for wealthy families who come in to see Burgundy that you'll find 90% of their money is invested in Canada. And so it's a peculiarly Canadian thing. So from the beginning, we have tried to develop skills in other markets. And it's been a very important part of the firm, and one of the reasons is that other countries often have much less perfect markets, much less perfect information than North American or Western European markets have, where there are many more rules about disclosure and accounting. For example, in Japan, there are something like 4,000 public companies, and half of them don't even publish information in English. And so it's actually quite easy to find mispriced securities, but you have to, it's very labor intensive. So at Burgundy, we have three people who do nothing but work on Japanese stocks. One of them is Japanese, and the other lived there and has a pretty good facility with the language. So it's, but not everybody could do that. But that would be an example of trying to take advantage, I guess, of imperfect information. We also maintain a big network of business contacts. these are clients of the firm. Some of these are consulting firms who we employ. This is kind of a controversial topic, and there's been some controversy over some business consultants, whether they're actually trying to get inside information or not. We're certainly not doing that. We do think that really understanding companies in a lot of detail is very, very important. And one of the things that helps us do that sometimes are retired executives of companies or in certain industries. And valuation is so important, is the price that you pay for them. So you can have great companies, but if you don't pay the right price for them, then it probably isn't going to work out too well. Now, on the top, George sent me an email, I guess when he was trying to encourage me to come up here, and he gave me a big long list of things he thought I should talk to you about. But one of them was idea generation. And sort of, I think a lot of people somehow think that you can screen, that you can sift through stocks like you had a big sandbox, you know, and you're kind of sifting away and finding things. We do some of that, but I can tell you that over time, very few of our ideas have ever come that way. And why is that? Well, it's because everybody does it. We want to do things that other people don't do and have insights that other people don't have. And so we have found that great ideas have tended to come from very different sorts of things. And one of the ways that some of the best ideas come is just plain from thinking about things and reading. I'm a tremendous believer in widespread reading, and I think that you know, just like your body is kind of what you eat, I think that your mind is, you know, it's kind of what you've learned over time, and it's what you've read over time. And we at the firm do try to sort of organize reading a little bit so that different people are reading different things. That we're spending a lot of time on things like trade publications. So in the media business, which we're very interested in the media business because there are a lot of oligopolistic kinds of businesses there, we read trade journals. One of our people, Alan McDonald, is a big reader of things in cable TV, internet, kind of media companies that got us very early into things like TripAdvisor. We spend a lot of time speaking to managements, as I mentioned to you, and attending conferences on topics that we're interested in. Another way that you often get great ideas are from people with whom you have a relationship and you've had a great experience with them as an investor. I wouldn't think of buying an insurance company without talking to Arrell. And when we were in Mexico last week, asked Walmart of Mexico, which is a spectacular company, really who were the people that they admired in specialty retailing. So asking somebody who's already got a great business about which of his competitors he admires, or who he thinks are doing the right things in the industry, has often been a sort of tip-off to good things. We also do some things to try to make us focus on those things that are out of favor. So every Tuesday morning at a large, we have a kind of all investment department meeting every Tuesday morning. There'll be 25 to 30 people there. One of the things we do routinely is go through the 52-week lows of the major stock market. So we're looking for companies which are hitting lows but are great companies. And it's just that it's a kind of screening thing, but it forces you to turn your attention to those out-of-favor things, whereas human, left to, you know, normal human tendencies, is always to be focusing on things that are doing well. We're trying to focus on things that are good companies, they're not doing well. I'm going to give you some examples of that. tapping into our global base strength, it's been an important thing for that we're actually operating in a number of different countries and are aware of trends and what are the good businesses in other countries, and sometimes you can apply that to your own situation. And you need screening. I mean, we do some of this sand sifting. I don't think it's so unique. But one of the things we do, for example, when we screen for profitability, we screen for companies who have high retained earnings and small share capital. Lots of people think about book value, but we think of the components of book value. Has the book value been created because they issued a lot of shares at a high price, right? Or has it been created because they actually had a small share of capital, but over many years they added to retained earnings? It's a very important distinction and tends to separate out companies that genuinely have high returns on equity and high cash flow. Here's a little schematic about the Burgundy investment process. I mean, I hesitate to put this up because it makes you sort of think that there's like a playbook about it, and there really isn't. But if you could divide the steps down, you know, we think a lot about, with every company, we think about business characteristics, barriers to entry, which we talked about, really looking for limited competition, looking for economic resilience, typically owning industry leaders. We are definitely not in the cigar butt business at all, but are really trying to buy good companies that are compounding in value over time. Managerial characteristics are so important, and we're going to spend some more time on this. I think this is the most important thing, actually. Capable and honest management. Capital allocation is something you can really study, how people did on capital allocation. What kind of returns are they getting on marginal capital they're investing in the business? Are they big owners of the business? What's the corporate governance like? These are very, very important points. They're sort of subtle, and you can't just quantify them entirely. I think it's very important. And financial characteristics. We're looking for companies with big free cash flow, low capital requirements, high returns on capital, and strong balance sheets. And companies that really are able to grow their intrinsic value over the long term. And then the third step is that we're separating those companies into those that makes any sense to buy them right now, which is usually a very small number. And the other is creating the farm club, right? So on the left there, the dream team is the junior ed of Burgundy, right? These are the ones that we like. These are the companies we really like. They're not at the right price. And frankly, that's most of the time. But I can tell you, and in April of 2009, when the market hit its low, it's not so long ago, but the stock market was a lot lower. We knew what to buy, right? We didn't have to sit around and think about what do we want to do. We already had the time club there. So it really gives you the confidence to act in a big way when there's great opportunity. So the concept of the farm club is a very important thing. Now, I think that another sort of idea at Burgundy that I'll just mention it. Buffett talks a lot about this, and it's a very important point, is the idea of circle of competence. You know, we're just not that good on commodities at Burgundy, for example. We don't think it's that good business, and we've never spent so much time on it. We think that commodities don't have barriers to unless you're a low-cost producer like Cementos Moctezuma that I mentioned, or some of the potash companies that we have in Canada, Cameco, the uranium producer. Unless you're really a low-cost producer, commodities are not so attractive. So I would say it is not highly in our circle of confidence. We've tried to build circle of confidence on those companies that we think really have barriers. That's how we've defined it. Now, I'm just going to give you a few quick examples. And of course, you know, I'm with McDonald's, I'm picking one that obviously is a big success. But a really big point here with McDonald's was in 2003, so it's a long time ago now, but there was a big beef scare. I mean, I don't know if you remember that, but the mad cow disease absolutely panicked people on beef. And in France, the legislature of France, somebody tried to pass a bill actually making it outlawing McDonald's. You know, they're going to put them out of business. And the stock, if you can kind of see back there in 2002, the graph, that's not such a good graph, but I think you can see that it went down quite dramatically. We figured out at the time that McDonald's, which has a lot of great qualities about it, obviously it's got a great brand name. I don't think it's much of a product, but they've done a great job of rolling it out. And one of the things that's quite unique about it, as compared to others in its business, is that it owns most of its land. And it really gives it something that you don't find all that often in retail. So we figured out in March of 2003, when McDonald's was collapsing, that actually, if you took all the McDonald's stores down and turned them into 9-11s or petrochems, that actually the shares were worth more. I mean, it really gave a floor to it. And so we did what we, when we get something like that, a great company at a great price, we have this saying at Burgundy that we back the truck up, right? When you get something like that, you want to buy a lot of it. And one of the problems in the investment world is that most people don't buy enough of the really good things. Because they don't know enough about it, haven't done the work. We've done the work. We had followed McDonald's for 12 years, but we'd never owned a stock. So it was on our dream team. So when it got there, this dream team really serves to push us in the direction of doing something, giving us the confidence to do it. So we bought millions and millions of dollars worth of stock. And we still own it in some places today, although not nearly what we once did. But you can see it's been a really great success. This has been a good one. I wasn't going to pick a lousy one to show you. And they don't all work out so well. But this would be an example of what we like to do at Burgundy. Buying a good company when it's out there. Yes?
One question about your sell prices. You sold at $75 there.
We sold some, yeah.
Your intrinsic value calculated with 22. So one of the concepts that we looked at when we were doing value investing is when to sell. And
right.
Usually most of us feel safe, or at least me personally, feel safe selling in and around your intrinsic value. You know, you don't want to get too greedy kind of thing. So
right.
Did anything change between your initial valuation and your sales?
Well, you know, I generally agree with what you said. But you know, with companies that are growing companies, I mean, people define value investing in different ways, right? We define it as buying really good companies, growing companies, when they're badly out of favor. I mean, that's our sort of thing. A lot of people with value investing are really fooling around with companies that have, you know, based on their book value or their working capital or something. It's sort of the classic Ben Graham sort of thing. I think with companies like McDonald's, what you face is that the intrinsic value is increasing all the time. So, you know, we are influenced by getting close to intrinsic value and often sell on that basis. But I think it's very important that you view intrinsic value as a rather more dynamic variable rather than just something that, you know, that's fixed in time. I mean, if you've got a growing company, that intrinsic value is improving hopefully every day. And I think with McDonald's, you know, was kind of like that. I mean, we did sell stock. I mean, in hindsight, I wish we'd sold nothing. We would be far better off. But it really has been one where the intrinsic value has gone up because the earnings and cash flow and dividends are just doing that. So we're reevaluating it all the time. Yeah. Yes?
Yeah, that was going to be my question. How often you revalue?
Yeah. I mean, sort of quarterly, you know. Yeah. But I mean, we're not redoing, I mean, do a lot of effort in to try to predict free cash flow and discount, but it's actually a rather mechanistic thing, and there's a lot of qualitative variables that I think you have to sort of bring to bear. And I mean, I very much see investing as there's some science, but there's a lot of art as well. Did you have your hand up, or you?
Same question.
Okay. Yeah. Is there another one? Now here's a funny one. And actually, I've got a big lot just outside of London. I drove by it tonight. And I've got a big. Do you know Ritchie Brothers? Big auctioneer. I think this is a great company. This is a real made in Canada, genuine company. We have been involved with this company off and on since it was a very small company. But this has built up a great auctioneering business for industrial equipment and increasingly for farm equipment as well. It's a really deep moat because there's a natural thing that if you're buying equipment or selling equipment, you want to be in the biggest, most liquid market that you can be. And initially, that would be by having a great big yard and having the most possible equipment and making it attractive for people to put their equipment into your sale. But they early on figured out that you could do this on the internet as well. So that the network effect has really expanded here even more. And they've figured out that they can do it all over the world. So Ritchie Brothers has gone from a little BC, company, I remember when it had $50 million in market cap, to really being an important international company. Dave Ritchie and his brothers started the thing and ran it out of their garage for a while, I think. I mean, it's a real rags to riches story. I think it would be very, very hard to compete against Ritchie Brothers. It's very solid business. It's to some degree cyclical with industrial activity and construction and so forth, but I think it's a really first-class company. We the current price $24. We think the intrinsic value is $30. Margin safety is $20. We would normally not be interested in buying companies if we couldn't buy them for a 30% margin of safety. That's sort of our rule. So when you see something like Ritchie Brothers at 20%, well, we bought it lower. Another great company of the type we were speaking of earlier with a really outstanding brand name is Heineken Holdings. And Heineken has a lot of great features. I don't suppose anybody in this room drinks much beer. Well, you all know Heineken. I don't need to tell you about it. But one of the things that's great about Heineken is that it's such a strong company in emerging markets. So, it really is one of those things. You can see where, third line down, you can see how much of their money they're making, 35% in Western Europe, 25% in the Americas, 21% in Africa, in the Middle East, and so forth. It's a very good company that way. This is a company that's got mid-teens operating margins. We think the margins are going up over time. Their two biggest competitors, SAB Miller and AmBev, have higher margins. And something I like a lot about Heineken's, is that there are Heineken's, right? The family still is very involved in the company. The chairman is a lady, who's a Heineken. And they really, we have found over time, actually, contrary to what you might think, that companies where there's a big family involvement or a big control block or somebody really cares have tended to be better companies over time than those that are so-called professionally managed, right, where nobody actually owns very much stock. And I think that the last 10 or 15 years has shown how many governance problems there are with those kinds of companies. And I think with family-run companies, I mean, there are examples of, a number of examples where that hasn't worked, right? You know, Conrad Black or something like that. But on the whole, we have found that family involvement is a very healthy thing that helps management to think long run, invest money long run, and generally try to do the right things. And I can tell you that the people behind Heineken are really, really committed to this business and have been for several hundred years, actually. They have a great balance sheet, they have some debt, but they have very manageable debt. There are no covenants on their debt. You can see the return on equity, single best measure of profitability and success, we think, 18% after tax. 5-year average has been 17%. You can see the earnings are growing 10% a year. It's quite good in this sort of field. And I think that our calculation at the moment is the shares trade at 31 euros and the intrinsic value is 46. We know the management of this company very well and have owned this. Burgundy has owned this stock for nearly 10 years. Now, I'd like to talk now a little bit about a topic that I don't know if you speak very much about this in this class, but it's the problem of human weakness. And one of the human sort of weakness things is that people really like to do what other people are doing about it, right? People, you know, you see it in people's dress and what people eat and what they do, and they all like to go to the same bars and restaurants, and there's just something about it that people have quite a bit of herd instinct maybe still remaining between them. And so, well, one of the things about investing is that you want to not do that, because generally speaking, standing apart from the crowd and taking advantage of the crowd is a very important thing to try to do. And I thought that, how many people in here have read The Intelligent Investor? Have you all read this? Is that sort of required? So that's one of the great, you know, it's one of the great books, and it's also very readable, and even though it's an old book, I think it's still pretty relevant. But I think that one of the great metaphors about investing is actually the idea that Mr. Market, right? Does he have any psychological problems?
Ethical pessimistic dude.
Right. What do you call that in psychology or psychiatry? Manic depressive. Mr. Market is manic depressive, and you know it's really an important thing to try and take advantage of that. So, you know, I think we had a great example just 3 years ago of Mr. Market in his depressive phase, and you know, if you bought stocks in April of 2009, less than 3 years ago, he made a lot of money. That was a great time to buy some great companies. And one of the problems in the investment business is nobody actually blows a whistle at the bottom, right? Or no alarm goes off at the top. And the cartoon here is, you know, showing the bull out there on the stage, and the bear is saying, well, do you want me to go on now? And the guy, the impresario, is saying, no, not yet. Nobody actually knows when that's going to happen. So having a dispassionate view about things, standing apart from the crowd, thinking for yourself, is a very, very good thing to do in this world. Now, it's very interesting on this point at the moment. What do you think, what is the crowd doing right now on the topic of stocks versus bonds? What's the crowd, is the crowd buying bonds or is the crowd buying stocks? Let's think about 2011, because it might even be changing. Yes?
If I go right now, actually.
Right.
I'd say the equities right now.
Right.
Bonds.
But
2011 is buying bonds.
Do you know the statistics for 2011? Well, U.S. mutual funds, which is, you know, the great unwashed public, put net $145 billion into bonds and took $7 billion out of stocks. That's what people as a whole did in 2011. Does that make any sense? So what yields were they getting to then?
About
3% maybe? Well, some of them would be maybe high yield things, but if they're buying government securities, then certainly wouldn't be more than 3%. And what sort of yield are you getting on stocks? It's a little bit better than that, actually. It's just as good, a little bit better. So it actually would be a great example, I think, of an irrational thing going on right before our nose. Now, why do you think that's happened? Why might that be happening? Yes.
I think there's two big reasons. The first one is a lot of investors are short-term looking, and the second one added to that where there was a whole thing about a double dip, and that was a huge reason why people didn't want equity.
Right.
Because you can actually get a negative return from equity, but in bonds, you don't really see a negative return on equity.
Right. So I would sum up that last point as people are scared. They're really scared from what went on in 07 and 08 and 09. I think the Lehman insolvency and all the things that happened really scared people and made me think that their money is secure with bonds and who knows about stocks. It's that kind of thing, right? But in fact, is that rational? Do you think bonds are that secure? Can it? Yes.
Definitely REIT bonds, very secure.
Aha. Well, we're going to call on George for the some comments on that. Here's the thing. In today's Wall Street Journal, they always are in the op. I think it's in the op-ed section. Are talking about Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart. Do any of you know these people? These are George. You might know them. These are famous economists at Harvard, who have written a book which is really describing the folly of government sovereign bonds over time. And I think the Wall Street Journal wrote about it today because we're reading about the Greek thing, right? But it led them into talking about Ken Rogoff and Carmen Reinhart's study of bonds. And you know that over time, the last 100 years, there have been 250 different sovereign insolvencies. One of them was Canada back in the late 1800s. Apparently. I didn't know that actually. There have been 15 American states that have been insolvent in the last 100 years. Germany has been, of course, insolvent at the end of World War II. Austria has been insolvent. I mean, it's not all just Argentina and Brazil and Mexico. There's some very high quality countries that have been insolvent. And I don't know, the way people are printing money, I really think that you just can't assume that bonds are low risk. This would be my point. I'm not trying to scare anybody about bonds, but I just think you can't blindly go along the way that some investment textbooks do, assuming that sovereign debt is really sort of risk-free. People talk about the risk-free rate. I don't think it's so risk-free. I think that when you can buy great companies at 10 or 12 times earnings with 4% yields, this is actually a lower risk thing than buying bonds where, in countries, even like the United States, which are frankly printing money like, those presses, if you listen closely enough, you can hear them going, and it's happening. So it's just something to bear in mind. Yeah, so again, talking about the panic, the importance of contrary thinking. The bear was all dominant in the early 2009. So here's a Mr. Martin. This is from Jim Grant, who should be a great friend to all value investors. I hope you know who Jim Granite is a Grant's interest rate observer, but he's a great contrarian thinker, and he, this is his cartoonist talking about taking advantage of Mr. Market. Now, how can you, given that we all have these human biases, right, which make you want to do what other people are doing and sort of stand in the way of good investing, what can you actually do about it? And we think quite a bit about this at Burgundy. And so, you know, there's a number of things that we do in the culture of the market. And one of the things that we do is that we don't have any committee. Now, this is very unusual. Firms that are of very much size in the investment business, or institutions, endowment funds, pension funds, usually they always have committees. And when you have committees, you tend to get what we call groupthink. We think that decisions should be made by people who are the most knowledgeable on being able to make decisions. So, for example, the person who runs our American equity, Steve Mitchell, he makes all the decisions. Richard Rooney and I and others might have views about it, and we might say what they are, but we never try to overrule things or second guess them. So I think one of the things that stands in the way of good decision making with stocks is this sort of feeling that you'll get into trouble if you make mistakes, or people will be critical of you if you make mistakes, or that standing apart and being contrarian is going to be criticized. So we've tried to do some things within our organization to prevent that from happening, to really give people the power to make decisions, not to have second guessing. And the other thing we've tried to do about that is not to be critical of mistakes, to be accepting of mistakes. We are in a field where you're going to have mistakes, things that don't work out. So having that sort of culture and building a culture of acceptance of mistakes is part of the whole action. Now, I talked earlier about the dream team. I think the dream team disciplines you to focus on things that are out of favor and trading for less than intrinsic value. And another thing that I tagged on here on this slide is the idea of humility. I feel very strongly that, you know, Mr. Market, as Graham would say, is a really formidable foe. And I think that people who are sort of cocky about things and, you know, think they know a lot of things really are making a big mistake. The most dangerous person on any investment company is the person who's been very successful recently, right? And because people take on a cockiness that can really override wise decision making. So I think having a sort of humble attitude, an idea of humility about it all, is a very important thing. Here's standing apart from the crowd, so you can see the crowd at the top, or everybody's positive. This would be, you know, 5, 6, 7, or earlier in the tech bubble, everybody's positive. And then down at the bottom, that would be what was going on in the spring of 09, just 3 years ago. Here's the committee. So you see, here's the committee, the investment committee. You can see what's in the middle of the table. Can you see that? Maybe it's not too clear. I think those are supposed to be fumes coming up from that, whatever it is in the middle of the table, and it's saying, okay, so none of us like it, but it's the only thing we can agree upon. Right? And this is what tends to happen in committee decision making. People sort of rally around mediocrity. And one of the things that I have found over my career is that institutions which have investment committees picking stocks tend to have very performance, which is very much like the index, because they agree about things, and usually those are things that are popular and being talked about. times. Now, here's my idea about U.S. bonds, right? Because this is the Thanksgiving Day parade. This is my friend Jim Grant's cartoon that he put out in his Thanksgiving Day issue. And you can see what he thinks of U.S. dollars. He thinks that they're just being puffed up and printed like mad. And any of you who have seen the Thanksgiving Day parade, the Macy's parade, know that it's dominated by these big balloons that people pull down Fifth Avenue. And you can see there the balloon of the U.S. dollar with all the air in it. Here's inflation lurking around the tent. Did you hear something? No, it's just the wind. Here's another one. By God, I remember when interest rates were interest rates. Now, how are we doing on time, George?
5 more minutes.
Okay, so, because I want to give time for questions. So I just want to come back on a couple of points about this all-important subject of barriers to entry. And I wanted to pose a question to you. Do you think that culture of a firm can be a barrier to entry? Do you think it's hard to create a good culture? What do you think about that? Does McKinsey, do you think they would have a great culture? Do you think it's been hard to create that? I think Goldman, until recently, thought they had one. But in Goldman's case, John Whitehead, who was the president of the firm for many years, the Lord is brave at what's happened there. It took many years to build a great culture at Goldman. And I think, until not so long ago, they wouldn't have had that. But do you think it's taken very long to do that? It shows you it can take years and years and years to build something like that. So, in some ways, a culture is a barrier to entry, but in other ways, if you make a mess of it, you can lose it, I think, in a hurry, can't you? So I wanted to bring that up. Another barrier to entry that sometimes people talk about is management, right? How are you going to create another Berkshire Hathaway? So management. What do you think about that as a barrier? A huge competitive advantage, but it's kind of like culture, you can lose it fast too if you don't get it right. I mean, if Berkshire doesn't pick the right guy to pick up the ball out of Buffett, it might not be so good. I mean, so it's a tricky one, and I think we've all seen companies where that's happened. I mean, I think Buffett, says, well, if you're depending on great management, I mean, eventually a turkey will run right the business. I mean, even we've seen some great companies. I mean, Johnson & Johnson, the current president's just leaving. I mean, I think he hasn't been so great. I mean, that was a great company for many, many years. But if you make an unwise choice, it can really hurt. I think this is an area where family businesses sometimes have an advantage. Being able to pick the right people and sort of stick with them and change them if it's necessary. Boards are often very slow. Is there another question? Can I hand up at the back? Yes.
Would that be more helpful if you use the manager internally? And
Sure.
It's not only a job, it's like a legacy.
That's right.
Carry out.
Right. No, I think you're absolutely right, and I think that that's one of the these aspects about family businesses that are sort of hard to quantify. I'm not sure that it's widely accepted even by people on Wall Street or by academics that this is true. But I think when you have a family business or somebody with a big block of shares in the company, they care about it, you know, more than the money. I've often said around Burgundy that I don't do this for the money. I mean, I would, and once last year I even said, well, I look after the clients for free if we had to, right? You know, I'm not aspiring to that. Every once in a while, some smart aleck will say, well, why don't you give it a try? I mean, there are people who really are, as you described, not doing it for money and have a deep sense of caring. And I think if you can find those, they tend to be good ones. Yes.
Can we do the Q&A now? Or you
sure. Yeah. I've got a little bit more line here, but we can take.
I don't get lost questions through the microphone, so I can take.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Finish what you have to say, then we'll talk to your questions.
Okay. All right. So I wanted to just, the last sort of topic that I wanted to just spend a few more minutes on is management, actually. And you know, I've kind of been harping on this, but I, 20 years ago, I would not have said, I mean, I wouldn't, early in my career as an investment analyst, I would not necessarily have thought management was so important. But today, I would say it's the most about anything that we invest in. And so it's hard to talk to a class like this about it because, you know, a lot of people would say, well, how do you judge that? How can you actually judge management? And so I just thought we should talk about it for a few minutes because I think there are some ways you can, you know, quantitatively judge them, but there's a bunch of qualitative factors as well. So one of the documents that we actually pay a lot of attention to at Burgundy that most people I don't think do is the Management Information Circular, which is prepared for the company's annual meeting. And sometimes it's called the Proxy Circular. And in the Proxy Circular, there's a lot of information revealed about the way the company interrelates with its senior management. And there have been all kinds of new rules put into effect because of the new rules on reporting in the last 2 years. And so the circulars have gone from being five-page documents to 50-page documents. There's a lot of material in there about the way management is paid, what the company thinks are the most important aspects of performance that the management can control. And I think by studying the information circular, you gain a lot of insight. Our test on management always is this. Is this somebody you'd like to be in business with? That is the test. And when we see people paying themselves egregiously, diluting the stock to create options egregiously, we would say to ourselves, we don't want to be in business with that sort of person. We also think that it's important that people their boards, shows the insights of boards, what kind of incentive schemes they create. I was looking at the information circular this morning, actually, for one of Canada's big banks, and one of the things that it said was that one of the key ways they judged the CEO was by how the bank stock did compare to the other bank. Now, what do you think of that as a way to judge people? My thought is, yes.
That depends. In the short term, it's for sure something that is
right.
Good, but on a longer term perspective, like 5 years,
right.
10 years.
I think if it was a 10 year,
much better.
If 10-year basis, I would agree with you. But I think in the short run, they only had 3 years. They had 1, 2, and 3 years in the circular. I don't think it means anything. But things that I would have thought, if I were running the bank, that I would think that the guy could actually do something about it would be market share of deposits, market share of loans. What is their reputational ranking, from surveys of their customers? How have they done building their international business? What's the return on total capital? Those would be things that somebody could actually do something about. I mean, I think whenever you get into stock market related things, you're really getting into the sort of land of the gods where there's not, some of it in the long run you do something about. But a lot of it is in the lottery ticket sort of category. And I think actually, Roger Martin at Rockland, I think I shudder George to mention such a name here, but Roger Martin has written a fantastic book about management lottery tickets as compared to incentive schemes that really are based on things that the person can actually do something about. So I think, I'm not going to go on about this anymore, but I think that when it comes to judging management, there's some quantitative things, and one of them is really careful study of the management information circular. I think another is careful study of this whole question of allocation of capital. Have they done a good job at it? If they bought back stock, did they buy it back when it was low, not when it was high? Very basic things. What's been the return on marginal capital invested? I also always read the letters that CEOs write to the shareholders. And in a lot of cases, you can tell in about the first 3 paragraphs, did that guy actually sit down and read and write that? Or did the PR department write it and put it in front of them and sign it? You can tell. And the really good managers, I think, write very compelling shareholder letters. You all know about Berkshire's letter, and probably George has told you that you should look at Fairfax's letter, but some other good ones too. One is Jamie Dimon's letter to the shareholders, who's the CEO of JP Morgan. I really recommend it to you. So there's some great ones out there, but they're in the minority. But those people tend to be very good executives in our experience. We look at what we always today, Google people, we try to see, usually CEOs are giving speeches around, or speaking at convocations, or speaking to shareholders, and try to listen to them and hear what they say. We never invest in anything at Burgundy unless we interview the company, and normally try to interview the CFO or the CEO if we can. We think a lot about these interviews. How do you structure interviews with senior management to get the most out of it? It's a big topic, and if we had more time, I'd go into maybe in the Q&A, we could go into that. But that's a big topic. We train our analysts that are early on this, how to structure open-ended questions to get people relaxed and talking. So the bottom line of all of this is, and my litmus test would be, would you like to be in business with this guy or girl? So in conclusion, to sum up, I think the key to great value investing, as far as we're concerned, is buying great companies, growing companies, when they're out of favor, and hanging on to them for the long term. We tend to hold shares for a long, long time. We've got 14 or 15 stocks in the company that we've had since we started Burgundy. And we think that letting good companies compound is a great way to make money. It's very tax efficient, avoids transactional costs. We try to take advantage of human behavior, as I said, and very much are focused on companies that have barriers to entry and would prefer family companies. So I'm going to stop there, and George is insisting that you go to the back and speak into the microphone. There we go. Do you take names? on this, George, to see who.
Yeah, if you can pick that up.
Yes.
Hi, my name's Sean.
Hi, Sean.
We talked a lot, in general about the buying company. I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the selling company, what sort of criteria you look for to get out, but, and if it's to be more specific, if it's just an internal thing that you're looking at, whether where the stock is at, like intrinsic value and stuff like that, or if you're comparing it to other opportunities where you can maybe better deploy the capital.
Well, both of those for sure would be the case. I mean, there are things which just plain get too expensive, becomes get too expensive, and you really got to sell them and move on. And there's times when there are simply better things to do with money, that's for sure. We try to limit portfolio sizes to something like 25 stocks, maybe 30 stocks. So we have a small, relatively small number of stocks, and we try to discipline ourselves not to let it balloon up if we find other things we like. So there is some of this selling one because something else is more attractive for sure. But I would say another big category of things which you haven't mentioned would be companies where they're just making some, you think it's good business, but they make some really dumb decision. And that happens more than you think, right? And very often, I would say the biggest category of that would be companies making big acquisitions. It's a classic sort of macho thing, which I don't know, CEOs seem to want to do, is to make big acquisitions. And I think that studies by McKinsey and others have shown that half or more of them don't work out very well. So we're really watchful of that sort of thing. I mean, making really bad choices about management could be making egregious compensation arrangements, that could be another one. So there's a number of those kind of things too.
Hi there, just wanted to say first off, thank you very much for coming today and speaking to us. I just had a question in regards to how you evaluate things like succession plans with management, because I know we discussed in our class as well, it's something that's sometimes not discussed or thoroughly looked at within firms, so how do you look at things like that when you're evaluating management as a barrier to entry?
Well, that's a big topic, yeah, and we think a lot about that actually, and we try to dig into that. Like, that's a question. So last week I was in Mexico City with our lady, actually, and met the class Filippini, who runs our emerging markets fund. We interviewed 19 companies. And in most of them, we talked about that. I mean, we were usually seeing the CEO or the CFO. And wherever we were talking to anybody who was over age 50, we were asking about this, right? So we really think about it, and sometimes people want to talk about it, and sometimes they don't. Sometimes they talk about it in annual reports, not usually. But I think it's really become pretty standard practice in bigger companies to think about this and to sort of have a plan. I mean, I think, on your manual for board of directors, I mean, everybody's running board of directors courses now, right? And trying to teach people how to be directors, which heaven knows we need. And but I think one of the boxes to tick is, do they have a succession plan? So I think the world is a lot better on this than they were 10 years ago. Yeah. Hi.
Hello. Thanks for your presentation. Your talk, you mentioned Japan,
yeah,
and how value can be hidden there because, like, other companies don't submit their reports in England.
Right.
So my question is, do you know if, like, have you noticed systematically under valued markets or industry, and is information availability or the lack of it the reason for that undervaluing?
Well, I think Japan's sort of an odd one, right? I mean, I think that the language thing, first of all, there's a lot of public companies in Japan. I think there's 4,000 or 5,000 of them, so there's a lot. And we have, in our Japan effort, where we manage quite a bit of money, I don't know, so much money do we manage in Japan? So I think $800 million. So it's quite a bit. But a lot of it is in small, outstanding companies. I mean, really those rare things that you would think of. I mean, we've got a company that makes these little tiny electric motors that go in, and they make the windows bubble down in your car and make the things go around in the DVD player. And this company's got a 70% market share, and it's family controlled, and they don't actually, there's no analyst following it. Right? Like, it's one of those funny things. They, in that case, do print things in English, but nobody actually follows it. So, in Japan, there's the main market in Tokyo, but there's also a smaller market in Osaka, and there's a kind of a NASDAQ, kind of a pink sheet market, too. So that's a particularly good one, I think, because it's an imperfect market. There are other countries like that. When I started in the business, the United States, the NASDAQ, what is now the NASDAQ market, they used to call it pink sheets, the stocks that, in the very old days, nobody even bothered to call the market, they just kind of printed it and flipped through it. And that used to be a real way you could, I would say that Bloomberg and the internet have really tended to probably reduce the scope of that sort of thing. I think the Japan thing is a rather unique. I couldn't name too many others that are like that.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I apologize, mine's gonna sound a lot like Sean's, but it's a little more specific. I was wondering in situations, we speak a lot about the catalyst as being like an event or a fundamental change that causes an investment to take off. I was wondering in a situation where the stock of an investment doesn't tank, but the catalyst never materializes, how you decide that it's time to cut the investment loss?
Yeah, well, we don't think much about that. We're not thinking about catalysts and stock. I think people who do that tend to be buying things that are sort of flattish things. We're looking for growing, successful businesses. If you looked at Burgundy's portfolio, you would see some of the best companies in the world in there. We're not buying dry dock companies and hoping somebody pays 20%. I mean, I would call those cigar butt things. So we're not thinking that much about catalysts. We're rather counting on the fact that good companies build the value of the thing over time, can reinvest capital in the business, can get a good return on it, and will grow over time. And gradually, things don't always trade at intrinsic value, but over time, they kind of, from time to time at least, trade at intrinsic value, and we just wait it out. I mean, we're not worried. I would say we do not spend very much time thinking about catalysts.
Great, thanks.
Mike? I have a question. What do you think is going to happen to the stock markets or indexes in the developed countries? Once the baby boomers start retiring and they got to cash in all their RSPs and mutual funds, do you think that's going to drag down multiples for us, or do you think foreign investors are going to step in and take them over?
I don't know. I'm a real optimist, about life. Right, long term. I mean, I think that the progress of mankind over time has been unbelievable. And whether you look at stock market prices like I did for 90 years, or life expectancy, or human health, or average income, I mean, the progress of mankind really is remarkable. And just in the last 2 years, a whole new section of the world is, in the Middle East, is sort of changing, and after being kind of locked in a system, and some of the countries are really improving. The most improving economy in the last 10 years, you know what it's been? Africa. Africa has been the most improving. A lot of people would say China, but actually Africa is really improving as a whole from a very, very low base. Not everybody, but so I'm really optimistic, and I think that capitalism is actually expanding. You know, when I was your age, back when the dinosaurs were still out, you know, the a big thing in the world was the Iron Curtain and the Soviet Union and all of Eastern Europe. And so it was a big part of the world wasn't even in the capitalist system. And that's not true today. I mean, you can say what you want about Russia or something, or the Eastern European countries, but they are increasingly real capitalist societies. So I think that maybe there's going to be some of what you're describing going on, but I think new things are being spawned. I think that the progress of business productivity, business success, because of the interconnectedness of people and the internet, is actually greater than it's ever been, and I'm really optimistic about the future.
Hi. You talked about succession planning in response to an earlier question, and a lot about family companies, family-owned companies.
Right.
And I guess when the founder is running the company, that's great, but over time, often there's a temptation to give it to the next generation, the third generation. And we've seen lots of examples of those working less than well because the family doesn't have the same, I guess, drive as the founder did.
Sure.
Just wanted to get your views on that.
I think that's a great point. And I think my comments about family businesses, I would restrict it, I guess, thinking really about the first generation form. I mean, there are people that make the transition. I would say you're quite right. I think the gene pool somehow sort of wears a bit thin somehow. Or it's probably not the gene pool, it's the motivation pool, really. I mean, there are exceptions to this, right? And I mean, there were some great exceptions, but on the whole, I think you're right. But somehow or another, the Heineken people have they've kind of institutionalized this idea of producing great beer and doing great marketing and offering great service to people. I mean, so it's the Heinekens are not supplying the CEO. They are not supplying the CEO of the company. The CEO of Heineken is a guy called Van Boxer, who's in Amsterdam. But the family very much are controlling the board. They're acting like good owners. I think the people beyond the first generation who are, unless they've got an exceptional person, son, daughter, really those are the kind that I like to see, that they're actually appointing management. But they're doing it, not just a bunch of retired guys sitting around the board just sort of theorizing about it. I mean, these are people making those decisions, and really got a lot of skin in the game. But I think you're absolutely right. What sort of people would you get in a job search if your son was one of the contenders? Right? I mean, you're just not going to get top people probably wanting to work in those kind of situations. But there are exceptions to this. Yeah. Good point. Well, culture is one of these things, it's hard to put your finger on. But, as somebody said, it's sort of like good art, right? You kind of know it when you see it, but it'd be hard to list it. I mean, to me, culture is about trying to do things right, trying to really do things right. Burgundy is a very small firm. We have 90 people. But we think tremendously about the culture. And we're always talking about it and how can we make it better and trying to evaluate ourselves on this. I mean, it's so I don't quite know what to say about it except that it's trying to get an environment where where really exceptional people want to work. I mean, that would be my definition of it.
I think there's actually a number of companies that are like that, where I'd be very worried if the person in New York wasn't there. You know, Berkshire could be one. You know, I think it's very, very hard. And I'm not sure, and I don't think they've got a culture of sort of thinking about this all the time. It's a very small thing. It's kind of it's a bit of a one-man thing. And there'd be other companies that you can both agree would be like that, for sure.
Coming today, and my question is more related to us. So we are graduating soon, and in the future we might be getting to value investing on those things. So what kind of expectations of you for us, like growing up to be a value investor in the future, and also what we can do like every day, like tomorrow, tonight, to prepare ourselves for those conditions?
Sure. Well, that's a big subject. How many of you here are really interested in investing? I mean, you think about it as a career kind of thing, as opposed to, passing the course and taking it because do people have to take it? Or has you heard how to pay it, George? How many are thinking about some sort of career? Well, quite a few. maybe I could tell you a bit about how I started. I actually was studying science, and I just by fluke, I an elective that I had in third year, mostly in science, you have to take all the time. You don't have any electives, but I got very fortunate. Took several courses in economics, and it had a huge, I just had one of these professors, you probably, hopefully all experienced it a few times, somebody who really sort of changed your life. But for me, I opened my first brokerage account, an investment account, when I was 19, and bought my first stock. It was a company called Supertest Petroleum, actually. It was subsequently taken over by Texaco, which I think is now part of Enron, but it was a great sort of experience. Sometimes you still see these old Supertest signs around, but so it really, for me, how did I learn about it? I mean, I think by sort of doing it, reading about it, thinking about it, and just really being interested in it. I think there's a sort of there's some things you've got to read. I mean, if you're going to be serious in the investment business, I mean, I just think there's if you're going into religion or something, there'd be 10 books you have to read, right? And probably start with the Bible and go on from there. But I mean, I think investing is sort of like that. I mean, I think there you would start with intelligent investor, and I mean, there's a book list. I think we have a list, actually, of things we're suggesting on our website at Burgundy. And I'm sure George probably has such a thing. But there are some things to read. But I think doing it is a great sort of thing as well. Have you invested any money? No. So a lot of people, it's very interesting to sort of ask people, well, why are you interested in investing, actually? And so, you get a lot of different answers to that. I mean, some people have sort of an intellectual interest. Other people just want to try to get rich. That's a good one. So, I mean, there's a lot of different motivations. The problem with investing is it's not a very, doesn't take very many people. you know, I mean, at Burgundy, maybe we've hired three analysts in the past year. I mean, it's just not a very, it's not something that employs a lot of people. I think sometimes good places to start on these things are more apt to be banks, insurance companies, brokerage firms that employ more people. I think it's very hard to start in investing. You almost got to do it. So I don't know if that probably doesn't help.
Thank you. Okay. Hi, thanks for being here. My name is Sylvia, and my question has to do with your approach to selling. And right. Is your strategy to hold on forever, like Buffett, or is your approach more?
Right. So we would hold on forever if we could. Right. We would. I mean, if values were reasonable and companies were compounding their value at 8-12% a year, we would hold them forever. It's pretty hard to find those things. But we do have some. I think we have, as I said earlier, a dozen or so stocks in the firm that we've had since we started the firm. I mean, Berkshire would be sort of an obvious one. But I mean, there's others. Johnson & Johnson, McDonald's, we had for a long, long time. I mean, so our preferred time to hold it would be for a very long time. I think it works out that the average is something like 7 years, 6 or 7 years.
So when do you sell again?
Well, as I said earlier, there can be a bunch of different things. I mean, one is things just get too expensive compared to their intrinsic value. Another thing can be dumb decisions on management's part, by way of which a big broad category would be unwise takeovers, unwise capital spending ideas, unwise choices in management, that sort of thing. So that's a pretty big category. And sometimes, as someone else pointed out, there's just something better to do with the money. That happens too. Yeah, so those can be the different reasons. Selling is more difficult than buying.
Thank you,
Sylvia. Do you get bonus marks, George, if you ask questions? Is that the way it works?
No. I have another leadership question for you.
Sure.
So one of the things we talked about was executive compensation. I know it's a very interesting topic right now.
Right.
And you mentioned it as an evaluation criteria for when you're looking at leadership of an organization, but how much is too much? So how do you actually value? So I know you liken leaders to art, and just like an art, as art get value. So I think something that would be interesting for everyone to know what you do, kind of your approach to looking at
executive. Yeah, so I don't know. It's hard to, that's really hard to say. You know, I think what's happened in compensation is that, by the way, if anybody's leaving, I brought everybody a present. I brought these very good pens up here. Okay. You know, I think that over the last 15 years, what's happened in compensation is that compensation has come to be a big, you know, subject of study, and a whole sort of generation of consultants evolved. And Ken Hugeson is one of the biggest ones in Canada, actually, and he came to be very, very influential. 20 years ago, bank presidents earned about $400,000. Today, they all earn between $10.5 million and $11.5 million. Do you think that there might be somebody who could do the job just as well for $8 million or $2 million? Or, you know, so I think that it's been driven up by consultants and by sort of the idea that, I mean, one thing which drove up compensation more than anything I can think of was when the Securities Commission passed rules that companies had to disclose compensation. When I started in business, they didn't disclose it, and the compensation was much lower. So now that they disclose it, right, do you think that any bank director wants, wants to say, well, actually, we pay in the bottom quartile. our goal is to pay our management in the bottom quartile. Everybody wants to pay, you know, at least in the second quartile. So it leads to this thing. I think that's a pretty big rate of gain in the compensation for bank presidents to go from $400,000 20 years ago to $12 million today. That's a big gain. And I don't know, some people sort of invent things, right? Like some people invented things or created companies from nothing, built, you know, literally turned straw into gold, right? I mean, people are critical of the management of Grimm these days, but I mean, for a long time, they spun straw into gold. That's worth a lot of money. How much was Jobs at Apple worth? I mean, that's worth a lot of money. Those people should be hugely paid. But I think that somebody could come in and run some big, you know, blue chip company. I mean, I like craft, but I mean, somebody could come in and, I mean, I don't think it would make very much difference for 5 years. Who knows, right? I think lots of people could run. So it's a really hard thing to answer, and I think as with many things in life, if you're in doubt, I think let common sense be your guide.
Sure. Thank you.
Hi, Tony. Thank you for coming tonight. My name is Cameron Smith. You talked about inflation tonight, and
right.
Sort of joked about it a little, and it's something I hear from someone of your age and wisdom quite a lot. My grandfather's born together quite a bit, and I'm wondering if you did that, like, how that touches your portfolio and sectors that you invest in,
right.
And then also looking at the U.S. dollar and investing internationally,
right.
And where you have, like, earnings coming back in pesos from your Mexican.
Right. Well, you're asking, yeah, you're talking about a very broad subject here. I mean, look, I remember when the mortgage on my house was 19%, okay? I had two little children, and my income went down that year, and I was an analyst at a securities firm, and I remember that. So it's kind of like somebody who lived through the Depression, right? You know, I know that interest rates, the natural rate of interest rates is not 2.5%. It is not. And I showed you, I think, on those statistics earlier that actually the long run thing on inflation has been 3.5%. But it has been, over 15% in my minor rate, and was there actually for some years. So I think. One of the things about investments, and you know, that experience actually is valuable, is that some of these lessons that you learned in the past, kind of, especially the painful ones, right, like that, you sort of remember that. So people who are buying houses with no down payment and getting mortgages that vary every month or every quarter or something, and right now they're, how much is it? 4.5%. But that could be in a heartbeat. That could be 7%. And if the person can't pay for it at that point, I mean that is. So these. So when you think about our portfolio, I mean, I would say we do think about that. And this would be. I mean, if people ask Burgundy to run balanced portfolios, that is to say, they can have stocks or bonds. That we would be tremendously highly skewed towards equities because we think that equities in bad times, good companies, can raise prices, better margins, cut costs, they're dynamic entities, right? Fixed income is nothing more than a contract. It's a contract to pay interest and a contract to get your money back someday. Maybe in highly likely to be in currency that isn't worth as much. So I think in portfolio management that this is a very critical point, is the point about inflation. And I just think it's something to be wary of. There's no sign of inflation in today's world, hardly at all. But you do know that money is being printed aggressively in England and the United States and some other countries. And it's not called that. I mean, there's all kinds of polite terms about it. What's the latest one? It's global expansion. Quantitative easing. So you all studied economics, and you know that in the long run, the price of the price index is sort of the sum of all the goods and services that are out there divided by how much money there is. And if there's more money, then I think one day you're going to have more inflation. But that is not a popular view at all. But that's my opinion.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Time.
Are you going to speak about the Greek bonds now?
So I have time, and I'll ask you the last question.
Sure.
That I always ask. What is the most important thing you've learned in life in investing over the last 30, 40 years?
Well, I think that the most important thing would be that people are the key, George. That, you know, that thank you. Judge accurately the character and ability of the CEOs of companies all the time, that would give me a huge advantage in investing. I think people